In the first place, we don't like to be called refugees. We ourselves call each other newcomers or immigrants. Our newspapers are papers for Americans of German language, and as far as I know, there is not, never was any club founded by Hitler-persecuted people whose name indicated that its members were refugees. A refugee used to be a person driven to seek refuge because of some act committed or some political opinion held. Well, it is true, we have had to seek refuge, but we committed no acts, and most of us never dreamt of having any radical opinion. With us, the meaning of the term refuge has changed. Now, refugees are those of us who have been so unfortunate as to arrive in a new country without means and have to be helped by refugee committees. Before this war broke out, we were even more sensitive about being called refugees. We did our best to prove to other people that we were just ordinary immigrants. We declared that we had departed of our own free will to countries of our choice. And we denied that our situation had anything to do with so-called Jewish problems. Yes, we were immigrants or newcomers who had left our country because one fine day it no longer suited us to stay, or for purely economic reasons. We wanted to rebuild our lives, that was all. And in order to rebuild one's life, one has to be strong and has to be an optimist. So we were very optimistic. Our optimism, indeed, is admirable, even if we do say so ourselves. The story of our struggle has finally become known. We lost our home, which means the familiarity of daily life. We lost our occupation, which means the confidence that we are of some use in this world. We lost our language, which means the naturalness of reaction, the simplicity of gestures, the unaffected expression of feelings. We left our relatives in Polish ghettos, and our best friends have been killed in concentration camps. And that means the rupture of our private lives. Nevertheless, as soon as we were saved, and most of us had to be saved several times, we started our new lives and tried to follow as closely as possible all the good advice our saviors passed on to us. We were told to forget, and we forgot quicker than anybody ever could imagine. In a friendly way, we were reminded that the new country would become a new home. And after 4 weeks in France or 6 weeks in America, we pretended to be Frenchmen or Americans. The more optimistic among us would even add that their whole former life had passed in a kind of unconscious exile, and only their new country now taught them what a home really looks like. It is true, we sometimes raise objections when we are told to forget about our former work, and our former ideas are usually hard to throw over if our social standard is at stake. With the language, however, we find no difficulties. After a single year, optimists are convinced that they speak English as well as their mother tongue. And after 2 years, they swear solemnly that they speak English better than any other language. Their German is a language that they hardly remember. In order to forget more efficiently, we avoid rather any allusion to concentration or internment camps we experience in nearly all European countries. It might be interpreted as pessimism or lack of confidence in the new homeland. Besides, how often have we been told that nobody likes to listen to all that? Hell is no longer a religious belief or a fantasy, but something as real as houses and stones and trees. Apparently, nobody wants to know that contemporary history has created new kinds of human beings, the kind that are put in concentration camps by their foes and in internment camps by their friends. Even among ourselves, we don't speak about the past. Instead, we have found our own way of mastering an uncertain future. Since everyone plans and wishes and hopes, so do we. Apart from these general human attitudes, however, we try to clear up the future more scientifically. After so much bad luck, we want, of course, as sure as a gun. Therefore, we leave the Earth with all of its uncertainties behind us, and we cast our eyes up to the sky. The stars tell us, rather than the newspapers, when Hitler will be defeated and when we will become American citizens. We think the stars more reliable advisor than our friends. We learn from the stars when we should have lunch with our benefactors and on what day we have the best chances of filling out one of those countless questionnaires which accompany our present lives. Sometimes we don't rely even on the stars, but rather on the lines of our hands or the signs of our handwriting. Thus, we learn less about political events but more about our own dear selves. Even though somehow psychoanalysis has gone out of fashion, those happier times are past when bored ladies and gentlemen of high society convened about the genial misdemeanors of their early childhood. They don't want ghost stories anymore. It is real experiences that make their flesh creep. There's no longer any need of bewitching the past. It is spellbound enough in reality. Thus, in spite of our outspoken optimism, we use all sorts of magical tricks to conjure up the spirits of the future. I don't know which memories and which thoughts nightly dwell in our dreams. I dare not ask for information since I, too, would rather be an optimist. But sometimes I imagine that at least nightly we think of our dead, or we remember the poems that we once loved. I could even understand how our friends of the West Coast during curfew should have had such curious notions as to believe that we are not only prospective citizens, but present enemy aliens. In daylight, of course, we become only technically enemy aliens. All refugees know this. But when technical reasons prevented you from leaving your home during the dark hours, it is certainly not easy to avoid some dark speculations about the relation between technicality and reality. No, there is something wrong with our optimism. There are those odd optimists among us, having made a lot of optimistic speeches, go home and turn on the gas, or they make use of a skyscraper in quite an unexpected way. They seem to prove that our proclaimed cheerfulness is based on a dangerous readiness for death. Brought up in the conviction that life is the highest good and death the greatest dismay, we become witnesses and victims of worse terrors than death, without being able to discover a higher ideal than life. Thus, although death lost its horror on us, we became neither willing nor capable to risk our lives for a cause. Instead of fighting or thinking about how to become able to fight back, refugees have got used to wishing death to friends and relatives. If someone dies, we cheerfully imagine all the trouble he has been saved. Finally, many of us end by wishing that we too could be saved some trouble and act accordingly. Since 1938, since Hitler's invasion of Austria, we have seen how quickly eloquent optimism could change into speechless pessimism. As time went on, we got worse, even more optimistic and even more inclined to suicide. Austrian Jews under Schuschnigg were such a cheerful people. All impartial observers admired them. Ah, it was quite wonderful how deeply convinced they were that nothing could happen to them. But when German troops invaded the country and Gentile neighbors started riots in Jewish homes, Austrian Jews began to commit suicide. Unlike other suicides, our friends leave no explanation of their deed, no indictment, no charge against a world that forced a desperate man to talk or to behave cheerfully to his very last day. Letters left by them are conventional, meaningless documents. Thus, funeral orations we make at their open graves are brief, embarrassed, and very hopeful. Nobody cares about motives. They seem to be clear to all of us. I speak of unpopular facts. It makes things worse that, in order to prove my point, I do not even dispose of the sole arguments which impress modern people. Figures. Even those Jews who furiously deny the existence of the Jewish people give us a fair chance of survival as far as figures are concerned. How else could they prove that only a few Jews are criminals and that many Jews are being killed as good as patriots in wartime? Through their effort to save the statistical life of the Jewish people, we know that the Jews had the lowest suicide rate among all civilized nations. I'm quite sure that those numbers are no longer correct. But I cannot prove it with new figures, though I can certainly prove it with new experiences. And this might be sufficient for those skeptical souls who never were quite convinced that the measure of one skull gives the exact idea of its content, or that statistics of crime show the exact level of national ethics. Anyhow, wherever European Jews are living today, they no longer behave according to statistical laws. Suicides occur only among the panic-stricken people in Berlin and Vienna, in Bucharest or Paris, but they also occur in New York, in Los Angeles, in Buenos Aires, in Montevideo. On the other hand, there has been little reported about the suicides in the ghettos and concentration camps themselves. True, we had very few reports from Poland, but we have been fairly well informed about German and French concentration camps. At the camp of Gurs, for instance, where I had the opportunity of spending some time, I heard only once about suicide, and that was the suggestion of a collective action. Apparently a kind of protest in order to vex the French. When some of us remarked that we had been shipped there pour crever in any case, the general mood suddenly turned into violent courage of life. The general opinion held that one has to be abnormally asocial and unconcerned about general events if one was still able to interpret the whole accident as personal and individual bad luck, and accordingly end one's life personally and individually. But the same people, as soon as they return to their individual lives, being faced with seemingly individual problems, changed once more to this insane optimism, which is next door to despair. We are not the first non-religious Jews persecuted, and we are the first ones who, not only in extremis, answer with suicide. Perhaps the philosophers are right who teach that suicide is the last supreme guarantee of human freedom. Not being free to create our lives or the world in which we live, we nevertheless are free to throw life away and leave the world. Pious Jews certainly cannot realize this negative liberty. They perceive murder in suicide, that is, destruction of what man is never able to make, interference with the rights of the Creator. Adonai Nathan ve'Adonai Lakak, the Lord hath given, and the Lord hath taken away. And they would add, Baruch Shem Adonai, blessed be the name of the Lord. For them, suicide, like murder, means a blasphemous attack on creation as a whole. The man who kills himself asserts that life is not worth living and the world not worth sheltering him. Yet our suicides are no mad rebels who hurl defiance at life and the world, who try to kill in themselves the whole universe. Theirs is a quiet and modest way of vanishing. They seem to apologize for the violent solution they have found for their personal problems. In their opinion, generally, political events had nothing to do with their individual fate. In good times or bad times, they would believe solely in their personality. Now, they find some mysterious shortcomings in themselves which prevent them from getting along. Having felt entitled from their earliest childhood to a certain social standard, they are failures in their own eyes if this standard cannot be kept any longer. Their optimism is the vain attempt to keep head above water. Behind this front of cheerfulness, they constantly struggle with despair of themselves. Finally, they die of a kind of selfishness. If we are saved, we are humiliated. And if we are helped, we feel degraded. We fight like madmen for private existences with individual destinies, since we are afraid of becoming part of that miserable lot of schnorrs whom we, many of us, former philanthropists, remember only too well. Just as we once failed to understand that the so-called schnorr was a symbol of Jewish destiny and not a schlemiel, so today we don't feel entitled to Jewish solidarity. We cannot realize that we by ourselves are not so much concerned as the whole Jewish people. Sometimes this lack of comprehension has been strongly supported by our protectors. And thus, I remember a director of a great charity concern in Paris, who, whenever he received a card from a German Jewish intellectual with the inevitable doctor on it, he used to exclaim at the top of his voice, "Herr Doctor, Herr Doctor, Herr Schnorrer, Herr Schnorrer!" So the conclusion we drew from such unpleasant experiences was simple enough. To be a doctor of philosophy no longer satisfied us, and we learned that in order to build a new life, one has to first improve the old one. A nice little fairy tale has been invented to describe our behavior. A forlorn emigre dachshund, in his grief, begins to speak, "Once I was a Saint Bernard." Our new friends, rather overwhelmed by so many stars and famous men, hardly understand that the basis of all of our descriptions of past splendors lies one human truth. Once we were somebodies about whom people cared. We were loved by friends, and even known by landlords as paying our rent regularly. Once we could buy our food and ride in the subway without being told we were undesirable. We have become a little hysterical since newspapermen started detecting us and telling us publicly to stop being so disagreeable when shopping for milk and bread. We wonder how it can be done. We already are so damnably careful in every moment of our daily lives to avoid anybody guessing who we are, what kind of passport we have, where our birth certificates were filled out, and that Hitler didn't like us. We can try the best we can to fit into a world where you have to be sort of politically minded when you buy your food. Under such circumstances, the Saint Bernard grows bigger and bigger. I never can forget that young man who, when expected to accept a certain kind of work, sighed out, "You don't know to whom you speak. No, I was the section manager at Karstadt's, a great department store in Berlin." But there is also the deep despair of that middle-aged man who, in going through countless shifts of different committees in order to be saved, finally exclaimed, and nobody here knows who I am. Since nobody would treat him as a dignified human being, he began sending cables to great personalities and big relations. He learned quickly that this mad world is much easier to be accepted as a great man than as a human being. The less we are free to decide who we are or to live as we like, the more we try to put up a front, to hide the facts, and to play roles. We are expelled from Germany because we were Jews, but having crossed the French borderline, we change into Boche. We were even told that we had to accept this designation if we were against Hitler's racial theories. During 7 years, we played the ridiculous role of trying to be Frenchmen, at least prospective citizens. But at the beginning of war, we were interned as Boche all the same. In the meantime, however, most of us had indeed become such loyal Frenchmen that we could not even criticize a French government order. And thus, we declared it was all right to be interned. We were the first prisoner volontaires history has ever seen. After the Germans invaded the country, the French government had only to change the name of the firm. Having been jailed because we were Germans, we were not freed because we were Jews. It is the same story all over the world, repeated again and again. In Europe, the Nazis confiscated our property, but in Brazil, we pay 30% of our wealth, like the most loyal member of the Bund der Ostdeutschen. In Paris, we could not leave our homes after 8 o'clock because we were Jews. But in Los Angeles, we were restricted because we were enemy aliens. Our identity is changed so frequently that nobody can find out who we actually are. Unfortunately, things don't look any better when we meet with Jews. French Jewry was absolutely convinced that all Jews coming from beyond the Rhine were what they called Polacks, what German Jewry called Ostjuden. But those Jews who really came from Eastern Europe could not agree with their French brethren and called us Yakis. The sons of these Yakis haters, the second generation born in France and already duly assimilated, shared the opinion of French Jewish upper classes. Thus, in the very same family, you could be called Yakis by the father and a Polak by the son. Since the outbreak of the war and the catastrophe that has befallen European Jewry, the mere fact of being a refuge has prevented our mingling with native Jewish society, some exceptions only proving the rule. These unwritten social laws, though never publicly admitted, have the great force of public opinion. And such a silent opinion and practice is more important for our daily lives than all official proclamations of hospitality and goodwill. Man is a social animal, and life is not easy for him when social ties are cut off. Moral standards are much easier kept in the texture of society. Very few individuals have the strength to conserve their own integrity if their social, political, and legal status is completely confused. Lacking the courage to fight for a change of our social and legal status, we have decided, instead, so many of us, to try and change our identity. And this curious behavior makes matters much worse. The confusion in which we live is partly our own work. Someday, somebody will write the true story of this Jewish emigration from Germany. And he will have to start with a description of that Mr. Cohn from Berlin, who had always been 150% German, a German super patriot. In 1933, that Mr. Cohn found refuge in Prague and very quickly became a convinced Czech patriot, as true and as loyal a Czech patriot as he had been a German one. A time went on, and about 1937, the Czech government, already under some Nazi pressure, began to expel its Jewish refugees, disregarding the fact that they felt so strongly as prospective Czech citizens. Our Mr. Cohn then went to Vienna to adjust oneself there. A definite Austrian patriotism was required. The German invasion forced Mr. Cohn out of that country. He arrived in Paris at a bad moment, and he never did receive a regular residence permit. Having already acquired a great skill in wishful thinking, he refused to take mere administrative measures seriously, convinced that he would spend his future life in France. And therefore, he prepared his adjustment to the French nation by identifying himself with our ancestor, Vercingetorix. I think I better not dilate further on our dear Mr. Cohn. As long as Mr. Cohn can't make up his mind to be actually who he is, a Jew, nobody can foretell all the mad changes he will still have to go through. A man who wants to lose his self discovers indeed the possibilities of human existence, which are infinite as creation. But the recovering of a new personality is difficult, as it is hopeless, as a new creation of the world. Whatever we do, whatever we pretend to be, we reveal nothing about our insane desire to be changed, not to be Jews. All of our activities are directed to this aim. We don't want to be refugees, since we don't want to be Jews. We pretend to be English-speaking people, since German-speaking immigrants of recent years are marked as Jews. We don't call ourselves stateless, since the majority of stateless people in the world are Jews. We are willing to become loyal Hottentots, only to hide the fact that we are Jews. We don't succeed, and we can't succeed. Under the cover of our optimism, you can easily detect the hopeless sadness of assimilationists. With us from Germany, the word assimilation received a deep philosophical meaning. You can hardly recognize how serious we were about it. Assimilation did not mean the necessary adjustment to the country where we happen to be born and to the people whose language we happen to speak. We adjust in principle to everything and everybody. This attitude became quite clear to me once by the words of one of my compatriots, who apparently knew how to express his feelings. Having just arrived in France, he founded one of these societies of adjustments in which German Jews asserted to each other that they were already Frenchmen. In his first speech, he said, "We have been good Germans in Germany, and therefore we shall be good Frenchmen in France." And the public applauded enthusiastically, and nobody laughed. And we were happy to have learned how to prove our loyalty. If patriotism were a matter of routine or practice, we should be the most patriotic people in all the world. And let us go back to our Mr. Cohn. He certainly has beaten all the records. He is that ideal immigrant who always, and in every country into which his terrible fate has driven him, promptly sees and loves the mountains. But since patriotism is not yet believed to be a matter of practice, it is hard to convince people of the sincerity of our repeated transformations. This struggle makes it our own society so intolerant. We demand full affirmation without our own group because we are not in the position to obtain it from its natives. The natives confronted with such strange beings as we are, become suspicious. From their point of view, as a rule, only a loyalty to our old countries is understandable. That makes life very bitter for us. We might overcome this suspicion if we would explain that being Jews, our patriotism in our original countries had rather a peculiar aspect, though it was indeed sincere and deep-rooted. We wrote big volumes to prove it, paid entire bureaucracies to explore the antiquity and explain it statistically. We had scholars write philosophical dissertations on the predestined harmony between Jews and Frenchmen, Jews and Germans, Jews and Hungarians, Jews and... Our so frequently suspected loyalty of today has a long history. It is the history of 150 years of assimilated Jewry who performed an unprecedented feat. By proving all the time their non-Jewishness, they succeeded in remaining Jews all the same. The desperate confusion of these Ulysses wanderers, who, unlike their great prototype, don't know who they are, is easily explained by their perfect mania for refusing to keep their identity. This mania is much older than the last 10 years, which revealed the profound absurdity of our existence. We are like people with a fixed idea who can't help trying continually to disguise an imaginary stigma. Thus, we are enthusiastically fond of every new possibility which, being new, seems able to work miracles. We are fascinated by every new nationality in the same way as a woman of tidy size is delighted with every new dress, which promises to give her the desired waistline. But she likes the new dress only as long as she believes in its miraculous qualities, and she will throw it away as soon as she discovers that it does not change her stature, or, for that matter, her status. One may be surprised that the apparent uselessness of all of our odd disguises has not yet been able to discourage us. If it is true that men seldom learn from history, it is also true that they may learn from personal experiences, which, as in our case, are repeated time and time again. But before you cast the first stone at us, remember that being a Jew does not give any legal status in this world. If we should start telling the truth that we are nothing but Jews, it would mean that we expose ourselves to the fate of human beings who, unprotected by any specific law or political convention, are nothing but human beings. I can hardly imagine an attitude more dangerous, since we actually live in a world in which human beings as such, have ceased to exist for quite a while. Since society has discovered discrimination as a great social weapon by which one may kill men without bloodshed, since passports or birth certificates and sometimes even tax receipts are no longer formal papers, but matters of social distinction. It is true that many of us depend entirely upon social standards. We lose confidence in ourselves if society does not approve us. We are and always were ready to pay any price in order to be accepted by society. But it is equally true that very few among us who have tried to get along without all these tricks and jokes of adjustment and assimilation have paid a much higher price. They jeopardized the few chances even the outlaws were given in a topsy-turvy world. The attitude of these few whom, following Bernard Lazar, one may call conscious pariahs, can be explained by recent events alone as the attitude of our Mr. Cohn, who tried by every means to become an upstart. Both are sons of the 19th century, which, not knowing legal or political outlaws, knew only too well social pariahs and their counterpart, social parvenus. Modern Jewish history, having started from court Jews and continuing with Jewish millionaires and philanthropists, is apt to forget about this other trend of Jewish tradition, the tradition of Hein and Rahel Varnhagen and Shalom Aleichem, of Bernard Lazar, Franz Kafka, and even Charlie Chaplin. It is the tradition of a minority of Jews who have not wanted to become upstarts, who prefer the status of conscious pariah. All vaunted Jewish qualities, the Jewish heart, humanity, humor, disinterested intelligence, are pariah qualities. All Jewish shortcomings, tactlessness, political stupidity, inferiority complexes, and money grubbing are characteristic of upstarts. There have always been Jews who did not think it worthwhile to change their humane attitude and their natural insight into reality for the narrowness of caste spirit or the essential unreality of financial transactions. History has forced the status of outlaws upon both pariahs and parvenus alike. The latter have not accepted the great wisdom of Balzac's "On ne parvient pas deux fois." Thus, they don't understand the wild dreams of the former and feel humiliated in sharing their fate. Those few refugees who insist upon telling the truth, even to the point of indecency, get in exchange for their unpopularity one priceless advantage. History is no longer a closed book to them, and politics is no longer the privilege of Gentiles. They know that the outlawing of the Jewish people in Europe has been followed closely by the outlawing of most European nations. Refugees driven from country to country represent the vanguard of their people, if they keep their identity. For the first time, Jewish history is not separate, but tied up with that of all other nations. The comedy of European people went to pieces when and because it allowed its weakest member to be excluded and persecuted. Thank you.
Thank you all for joining us. Again, my name is Maren Robinson. I was the dramaturg for this piece. This is Mechelle Moe. And I wanted to say just a few words about our process, and then hopefully we'll have some time for discussion and some questions from you guys, because I think it's a challenging piece, and that was one of the most exciting things to me about this when Allison brought me this essay, was the idea that the skills that we would bring to it as theater practitioners and the way that we work through difficult language and difficult ideas is something that we could do to sort of share this piece. And then here, as I think both of us feel that there's a value in everyone hearing and the shared experience of a text, and that by doing that, then we could have a conversation about something that is still a difficult issue, both in the US and elsewhere. So. For us, just a little about the process. I'm primarily a dramaturg, so my way of attacking a piece is to sort of look at some of the history of it. And in this case, I think Arendt has her own history is so personally tied up in what she's talking about, and yet she's able to separate herself and think about this and think about her state intellectually. So one of the things that we discussed as we worked through it is sort of her own history as a refugee. Her parents actually fled Russia, thinking that Germany would be safer as a place to raise a child. She herself fled Germany and went to France, where she was, in fact, interned during the Vichy regime. She escaped from GERS and fled through Europe for a matter of months before she was able to get papers that were able to bring her to the United States. And then it took her 10 years when she was in the United States to get citizenship. So there's a way in which that history, which feels like it should be very personal and that there should be a certain sort of outrage, which I think only sneaks in little places in that essay, she's able to sort of step aside and try and analyze what has brought her to this point, and has brought the people around her similarly to that point. When she wrote this, she wrote it for a newspaper in the United States. She was at that point 37 years old. She'd arrived here when she was about 34. So it's actually quite early in her sort of intellectual career. And then I think probably the other key piece is that when she was living in France, she was working for refugee organizations, and she was trying to help place children as they were being displaced. So she was thinking about it personally as much as she was thinking about it from the sort of political perspective and the sort of perspective as a political thinker, which is what her PhD and her work and how she thought of her academic work. But just to start off really quickly with Mechelle, who came to this process late and was lovely and tackled what is a really difficult essay with a lot of foreign phrases and a lot of really long sentences with complicated ideas. What for you was the most challenging in coming to this piece, and perhaps what was most exciting about it?
The complexity of ideas, and I think there's a difference when text is written to be performed versus written to be printed. And so to try to find what that voice was, you know, my first question was, this a speech that was given to help with the flow of it? Because you write differently depending on the medium in which it's received. So it's very much a newspaper journal, the complexity of the ideas and all the different threads. But I think ultimately finding her connections throughout, because I do think, like you said, she has like kind of an outside in, but there's definite, like, where's the emotion of the piece and where it's really personal to her pops out. So just kind of breaking it down in that way and finding a more natural speak to it in the process. But ultimately, I think, in our conversations when working on it, this is the feeling that the feeling of refugees and this loss of identity, searching for identity, what it drives you, this idea of statelessness. I mean, that's still present day, you know, and the universality to all of this, I think is the most exciting to me about the piece. And sad.
Yeah. I noticed that there were a couple of places throughout, and it's always fascinating when you get a shared group like this, when you suddenly hear responses, because this has been Mechelle and I in a room with her reading it aloud and me saying, what about this, what about that? So to hear the places that people verbalized and made these gut responses, right, and I think a lot of that really was the sense of, a number of those came on the moments that were about the loss of country and the loss of identity. I want to open it up to you guys, because this is part of why sharing this aloud allows us to kind of have that shared experience. So yes, thank you for bringing the lights up. I know we have a microphone. Actually, I'm curious too. Do we have anyone in the room who is an immigrant who went through the process in the United States of becoming? So at least one person knows what that experience is like now, or a couple of you. Yeah. Does anybody have any questions or ideas or thoughts that they would like to share?
The more things change, the more they stay the same almost. What bothers me, when I look at what happened to the Jewish population from the 1930s on and immigrating to other countries in France or to Latin America or to the United States, today we see lots of refugees going from Africa, dying in the Mediterranean Sea. trying to reach a place of safety. I think we as human beings in general, we should be able to change our minds of how to relate to each other and how to accept the other, how to accept the different. People who come across the desert from Mexico or drown in the Mediterranean trying to reach, are those people doing this to be illegal or to be to break the law, or are they just trying to find an opportunity to survive and take care of themselves? So I tend to think that you know, we should always think of it in a more human way.
Thank you. I think that hits on exactly why this essay resonated so much with us and with the festival is because there is so much that is still the same for people who are leaving countries and experiencing what it means to be a refugee and experiencing what it means to deal with the red tape of and the dangers which you articulated very well. So thank you.
Hi, I'm also, I come from Mexico. I went through all the process of being a permanent resident. And one thing that really astonished me and my daughter is that when we were doing all this process, we were called aliens. So my daughter was really like, why am I an alien? And even though I have my PhD in education and you know, I come here to be a good citizen, and every time we need to make some questions to the immigration offices, the first thing they ask us is, give me your alien number. So they don't ask for my name, they don't care about my last name, but only the alien number. The process, and I can understand why sometimes people decide to cross the border like that, because it's really challenging. You need to be wealthy and educated to fill out those forms. And when you're in the process, my husband is Jewish, and we were, my daughter and I, in the office for all these medical examinations, and all of a sudden, all of the ladies one side, the men the other side, you go there, and then they separate my daughter, Emma, and myself. She had to go to one room and went to another room, so it was a little bit like, to me, it brought to my mind those stories about Jewish, you know? And that was 3 years ago that this happened. So I really empathize with what you're reading, and even though I guess it's in 1930s, this was 2 years ago, so I really, I can feel what the writer was writing.
Almost the lose-lose of the situation, right? To escape one horror, to be entering into a new. with the internment camps, and like when she says in there, you know, you're put into concentration camps by your foes and internment camps by your friends.
Yeah.
Right? You're going to be a good citizen, but make sure you're in the house and locked up by 8 p.m. Like, don't go out, you know, and it's just, what does that do to your psyche as a human being to be stripped of those normal, just to have someone look at you and treat you and see you as a human being and with the same respect. And I think a lot of what she talks about in that piece is people losing their entire life that they built and then starting out in a new place with none of that same status and leading to all the suicides and things like that. And it's really scary what that can do to a person when you really stop looking at them as a human being and trying to understand who they are and what they desire to do. It's really easy. It's scary when people start becoming numbers, yeah. Right?
Is it online somewhere, do you know?
It's been published in a volume, which is where this one came from. So there's a collection. It's in a collection of essays. I don't know if it's available online.
Yes, you can.
He says yes.
Yeah. Okay. I'd like to go back and you can.
It's worth going back through because it's a tough essay, and she makes some really sharp and difficult hairpin turns. And I think really that end part, where she's suggesting that maybe, I think it's kind of counterintuitive about our American melting pot. She's actually calling for the maintaining of identity and maintaining it from a place of clarity and independence, even if that means making yourself a pariah. To do so is a really challenging but exciting concept. So I'd encourage you to go back and read it. Thank you. Thank you guys all for staying with us today.